Hi there, Marius here with the Resuscitation Coach. On this channel, we do all things resuscitation, so please consider subscribing. In today's video, we'll be discussing the Neonatal Resuscitation Program, or NRP 8th edition algorithm. So let's jump straight in. Here we go. Asphyxia is associated with both an increase in mortality and morbidity. By learning the skills of neonatal resuscitation, we can make a difference in outcomes. Most newborns make the transition to extrauterine life without intervention. Within 30 seconds after birth, approximately 85% of term newborns will begin breathing, and an additional 10% will start breathing in response to drying and stimulation. To successfully transition, approximately 5% will receive positive pressure ventilation, or PPV. 2% will require intubation, while 1 to 3 out of 1,000 births will receive chest compressions or medications. So why do newborns require a different approach to resuscitation than adults? Most often, adult cardiac arrest is a complication of coronary artery disease. It is caused by a sudden arrhythmia that prevents the heart from effectively circulating blood. As circulation to the brain decreases, the adult victim loses consciousness and stops breathing. At the time of arrest, the adult victim's blood, oxygen, and carbon dioxide or CO2 content is usually normal, and the lungs remain filled with air. During adult resuscitation, chest compressions maintain circulation until electrical defibrillation or medications restore the heart's function. In contrast, most newborns requiring resuscitation have a healthy heart, and when a newborn requires resuscitation, it is usually because of respiratory failure. So let's look at the top part of the new NRP algorithm. As always, we will start off with the four pre-birth questions that we need to ask the obstetric provider. These four pre-birth questions will guide us with our equipment and manpower preparation. Gestational age. Amniotic fluid clear. Additional risk factors. Umbilical cord management plan. The umbilical cord management plan have been added to the four pre-birth questions, replacing how many babies. Remember, team, that every birth should be attended by at least one qualified individual who can initiate resuscitation and whose only responsibility is the management of the newly born baby. If any risk factors are present, at least two qualified individuals should be present solely to manage the baby. The number of staff available will be determined by the risk factors. So it's important to always consider all the antepartum and intrapartum risk factors. It's extremely important for the obstetric and newborn healthcare providers to coordinate care by establishing effective communication. Once the pre-birth and risk factors have been considered, we can start with our manpower and equipment preparation. I use the memory aid or acronym HOST to guide me to do a quick and effective check. H for heat, O for oxygen, S for suction, S for stethoscope, ET equipment, and drugs. See the card above for our video on the NRP quick equipment check. At birth, we need to ask the following three questions. Term gestation, good muscle tone, breathing or crying. If all three questions is answered with a yes, the baby can stay with the mother for the initial steps, routine care, and ongoing evaluation. If any questions is answered with a no, the initial steps needs to be initiated. The initial steps have been reordered to better reflect common practice. As always, we will place the baby on the warmer, we will dry and stimulate, don't forget to remove the wet linen, and then position the airway. At this point, clear the secretions if needed. If the baby does not have apnea or gasping and the heart rate is at least 100, we should ask if there is labored breathing or do we have persistent cyanosis. If the answer is yes, we can suction if needed, attach pulse oximetry, and if indicated, we can start providing oxygen and or consider CPAP or continuous positive airway pressure. If the baby has apnea or gasping and the heart rate is below 100, immediately start with PPV. Remember, team, that the most important step in neonatal resuscitation is ventilating of the baby's lungs. Notice the vertical line on the left side of the algorithm. It has been moved to the top of the PPV rectangle to indicate that PPV should start within 1 minute of birth and that pulse oximetry and cardiac monitoring can follow that. Remember, we need to ventilate at a rate of 40 to 60 breaths per minute, which is approximately one breath every 1 to 2 seconds. Breathe, 2, 3. Breathe, 2, 3. Breathe, 2, 3. If you cannot ventilate the baby properly, don't forget the ventilation corrective steps of Mr. Sopa. Mask adjustment, reposition. Then you'll try again by giving 5 breaths and assess the chest movement. If no chest movement, try the next steps of suctioning and open the mouth. Try again. If it's still not working, increase the pressure. If that is not working, consider an alternative airway. After 30 seconds of PPV that ventilates the lungs, as indicated by an increasing heart rate or chest movement, we will check the baby's heart rate response again. If the heart rate is greater or equal to 100, PPV has been successful. We need to continue ventilating at 40 to 60 breaths per minute, monitor the baby's chest movement, heart rate, and respiratory effort. We need to also adjust the FiO2 as needed based on the pulse oximetry and the use of target oxygen saturation table. When the heart rate is consistently greater than 100, gradually reduce the rate of PPV. Observe for effective spontaneous respiration and gently stimulate the baby to breathe. Positive pressure ventilation may be discontinued when the baby has a heart rate continuously greater than 100 and sustained spontaneous breathing. If the heart rate is at least 60, but less than 100, and the heart rate is improving, continue to administer PPV as long as the baby is showing steady improvement. Monitor the oxygen saturation and again adjust the FiO2 based on the target saturation rate. If the heart rate is not improving, consider each of the following. Quickly reassess your ventilation technique. Is your chest moving? Are we ventilating at a rate of 40 to 60 breaths per minute? Do we hear breath sounds? If necessary, perform the ventilation corrective steps. And also adjust your FiO2 to meet target saturation ranges. If not already done, put a cardiac monitor on. Considering an advanced airway like an LMA or an endotracheal tube. If available, call for additional expertise to help problem solve the situation. If your heart rate is less than 60, again, make sure you have your monitor on. Make sure to consider LMA or endotracheal tube. And again, get expert advice. If heart rate remains below 60, despite at least 30 seconds of PPV, turn the FiO2 immediately to 100% and start chest compressions and review after 60 seconds. After 30 seconds of PPV, another 60 seconds of chest compressions, and the heart rate remains below 60, consider epinephrine. Epinephrine ET or IV IO doses have been simplified for educational efficiency, making it easier to remember. Our epinephrine concentration is 0.1 milligram per mole, which is 1 milligram per 10 mole or 1 in 10,000. Our ET dose is still the same as in the 7th edition, 0.5 mls to 1 ml per kilogram. But for simplicity and for educational efficiency, we'll be using 1 ml per kilogram. Our IV dose is the same as with the 7th edition. It's 0.1 to 0.3 mls per kilogram. But in the 8th edition, we'll be using 0.2 ml per kilogram. The American Academy of Pediatrics does not dictate which dose you should use. And ultimately, the decision will be that of the clinician. The cessation of resuscitation efforts have been expanded in the 8th edition to 20 minutes if all appropriate steps has been performed versus the previous standard of 10 minutes if no heart rate was present. For more information about the 8th edition, link is in the description below. If you benefited from this video, kindly like, subscribe, and smash that notification bell. We'll see you in the next video. Have a fantastic day.